Children in schools around the world are often herded into classrooms, right? They're taught to memorize things, recall, recollect, regurgitate information back onto test papers. Teachers are forced to think about what these children are doing and to think about how they might recollect this. Quite often, children are just passive beings. They're in classrooms, right? And they're just there. They're just taking in information. They're not processing this information. This is a really serious problem. What we want to see instead is engaged participation. We want to see children raising their hands, asking questions, engaged in the learning process, right? But quite often we don't see this. In fact, if we look at many cultures around the world, quite often we see that children are taught not to ask questions. They're taught that respecting your teachers is actually mutually exclusive of intellectual curiosity. This is wrong. So how can we change the way in which our children are thinking? How can we teach our children to think better? Well, there's some issues here. First, education is very costly. First and second world countries around the world, it costs between $10,000 and $12,000 per student per year. And this is what countries are investing in education. It costs billions of dollars a year to educate children. And the decisions on how to educate children are being made at the top level. So what can we do? Should we wait? Should we wait for these educators and these government officials to make change? We can't. Here's an example. In the United States right now, there's a push for what we call Common Core curriculum. And this Common Core curriculum is aimed at creating a systematic way of teaching arts and mathematics across the 50 states of the United States. It's cost hundreds of million dollars and taken a decade to do this. And it's still rife with problems. So what can we do? Well, I'm going to argue that we can use elephants to teach kids. Wait a minute, you guys are thinking, what? He just talked about all the problems that we face, and he's telling us we're going to teach kids using elephants. Well, let me take a step back for a minute, and before I tell you how we're going to do that, I'll tell you a little bit about myself. I'm actually not a trained educator. No one ever taught me how to teach. I enjoy teaching, but I never learned how to do it. I'm actually a psychologist, and I've been trained on understanding how people and animals think. So why should we care about this? Well, on one hand, studying the intelligence of an animal like elephants tells us a lot about ourselves. I want to understand how elephants think, how they see, hear, and smell their natural worlds, because this will tell us a lot about evolution as a process in general. But I'm also really interested in conservation. And elephants are on the verge of extinction on two continents, Africa and Asia. And we've got to come up with unique ways to try and save elephants. And one way we can do that is to try to better understand them. But there's a third, and that's educating children, because children love elephants. So let me show you some videos of my research. This is Pepsi, and Pepsi is a 10-year-old bull elephant living in northern Thailand in Chiang Rai. And I wanted to see whether or not Pepsi could recognize himself in a mirror. So over several days, I gave him exposure to this mirror, and then I marked him on the right side of his face with non-toxic face paint. If Pepsi recognizes himself, maybe he should reach up and touch the X on his face, rather than reach out and touch the X on the mirror. But what does this mean? Why should we care? Does Pepsi recognize himself? Is Pepsi self-aware? Does he have empathy? Is he able to connect with others? Does he care what's inside his mouth? Wanali on the right, Jojo on the left. These two elephants live in Lampang, Thailand, and I was interested in looking at whether or not elephants could cooperate with each other and how they thought about cooperative relationships. The way this task works is there's a single rope thread through and around this table. So if Wanali pulls this rope before Jojo arrives, the rope becomes unthreaded from the table. What does Wanali need to know? Does she need to understand how cooperation works? Does she need to wait for Jojo's arrival, and does she need to know that partnership matters? Well, I'm sure many of you want answers to those questions, and I'd be happy to give them to you later. But hopefully this encourages all of you to think. And what I've realized over the last 5 years is that this encourages children to think as well. So for the past 5 or 6 years, my team and I have decided to move from just studying the intelligence of elephants to trying to figure out how we can link that to children. So this is an example of a group of children in northern Thailand, and they asked us a lot of questions after seeing the elephants do those different types of tasks, cooperation, mirror self-recognition. They wanted to know if elephants could use their sense of smell to find food. So we asked the kids, how would you test this? How would you find out? They did an experiment like this, where we put food in a bucket, and the elephants needed to find it simply by using their trunk to smell it. Now, kids in Thailand have great access to elephants, but kids in the United States or Europe might not. So we found a way to beam elephants into classrooms using Skype. And obviously, we also beam ourselves into classrooms via Skype. Not only myself, but other scientists, climate change planners, artists. The idea is to get children to think critically about the world around them by helping them to ask questions. This group of kids had an interest in the relationship between elephants and humans. So they asked if we could do an experiment to see whether or not elephants could interact with humans and figure out where food might be by the signals that people were providing. They would point at different buckets. Now, the kids weren't in Thailand, but they designed an experiment, they carried it out with us, and they co-authored the peer-reviewed scientific publication that came out of it. But you don't necessarily need elephants to teach kids how to think. This is an example of a game that we play. We call it the Losing Space Game, and I'll show you the video and then I'll walk you through the game. So the way this game works is it's kind of like musical chairs, right? It's really simple. All you need is a single sheet of newspaper, and you turn the music on, and the kids walk around the newspaper, and as soon as the music turns off, they jump on it, right? They got to find any available space they can. And progressively, we make the paper smaller and smaller. We put it into halves. And the children have to find a space, so maybe they hug each other, or if they're very competitive, they might push each other off. But we're not giving the kids facts here. We're just trying to get them to think. So maybe all of you are thinking, what does this mean? Well, this has a lot to do with human-wildlife conflict and habitat loss. This is the biggest issue facing Asian elephants. So we want the children to think, what happens if elephants lose space? Again, I'm not up here to answer these questions for you. I'm here to try and get all of you and your children to think about what these answers might be. So you can do activities like this both inside and outside the classroom. If you've got access to elephants, use it. But if you don't, reach out to us. We'd be happy to figure out how to get you guys involved with elephants. But here's a really unfortunate fact. Past and current generations have really failed our children. We've created an incredible number of problems that next generation is going to have to solve. And remember, our children are the next generation of conservationists, educators, environmentalists, political figures. We've got to be able to figure out how to engage children in the learning process. We want them to reflect on what they know, but also to ask questions about what they don't yet understand. So what can you all do? Well, you could try to engage government officials, but you can also do things at the grassroots level. You can come up with activities on your own in your own communities that engage your children and excite your children and their peers. Reach out to teachers who can design extracurricular activities with you that you can use to get your children to think. Reach out to local scientists or artists. I promise you these people will be just as excited about educating your children as you are. So remember, what we need to do is work together to make this happen, to change the way in which our children think. Let's enable our children, using elephants or not, to change the world. Thank you.